All right, thanks, Andrea, for the introduction. I noticed that there was a slight additivity problem in the times. So, because it seems that there are two talks within the next hour, and one is 60 minutes long and one is 20 minutes long. So, but I can talk for 60 minutes.
Okay.
I wasn't sure. Okay, if you get bored, you just boo me off the stage. So, the second talk is dedicated actually to the Rydberg gases that I was kind of introducing yesterday and that were elaborated on today by Robert Loew. So what I'm going to talk about is many-body physics today, and in particular the out-of-equilibrium dynamics of long-range interacting Rydberg gases. So just like yesterday, this is the slide, local hero, Robin Hood. There's a bunch of names here highlighted in red. I hope I haven't forgotten anyone. Those are all the people that, in one way or another, have contributed to what I'm going to talk about in the next 50 minutes or so. Right, so and this is the outline of the talk. As I said, focus today will be on many-body physics. So, and what I want to advertise in the first part of the talk is something we have been pursuing in Nottingham now for quite a while that relates to soft matter, in quotes, type of physics that you can conduct with excited atoms. I want to convince you at the beginning, so that dynamics is more than statics, so this allows me to make a point, in the sense that I hopefully will be able to convey that this somehow makes sense, to think of soft matter-like problems within the context of Rydberg gases. I will talk a bit again about the atomic physics, just basically doing a recap of what Robert Loew has been talking about earlier today, and I will talk about noisy systems, and in particular how noise effectuates a particular kind of many-body dynamics that can be described by so-called kinetic constraints. I will talk about this in detail, what that means. And then I focus on actual dynamics of the system. I will explore how a gas of driven Rydberg systems that is excited on resonance actually evolves, and we will find some interesting behavior, at least I believe so, that this is also interesting to you. Namely, we will find that there is a self-similar evolution of the system. And this, in fact, the evolution can be described by a so-called scaling solution. And then in the third part of the talk, let's see how far we get, I'll discuss a non-equilibrium phase transition that you potentially can also study with the help of excited atoms. I will also show you some experimental results, and I will particularly highlight that these Rydberg atoms allow you also, in principle at least, to explore really the competition between noise and quantum effects in these systems. And last but not least, I want to connect to a real-world problem where we apply the methodology that is being developed here in the context of Rydberg gases to something that is actually relevant, for instance, in medical imaging, namely nuclear magnetic resonance imaging, and I will show you how one can actually exploit and understand non-equilibrium methods that go under the name dynamical nuclear polarization through this framework that is being established here in the context of Rydberg atoms. All right, so first punchline is dynamics is more than statics. So what do I mean by that? So let's make it simple. Let's just consider a system formed by our beloved spin 1/2 particles. And just make it very easy. Let's suppose we have a classical evolution in the sense that transitions between those two states are described by rates. One rate is for going up. One rate is for going down. And the system is even is simple, although it's many-body, it's non-interacting. That means, okay, spins flip independently, so you wouldn't expect anything fancy to happen. Yeah. So just keep this in mind for a second, and then I want to contrast this now with a so-called kinetically constrained system. That means spins can only flip from up to down, provided that, for instance, the neighbor, the left neighbor, is in the excited state. Yeah. So now you will think clearly these systems are completely different, right? One is non-interacting, and one is interacting. And of course now, if you look at an ensemble of those spins, you find here black, this axis is space, so this is just a line, and this is time. And you see spin ups are represented by a dark dot, spin downs are represented by a white dot, and you see indeed, these systems behave differently, so far so good. You see here, as you expected, all the spins flip independently, so there's just a bunch of noise, and you see the system relaxes very quickly. Whereas in this case, owed to the kinetic constraint that allows spin flips only when the configuration of the neighborhood is in a specific state, you see a highly intricate dynamics, yeah, which is clearly correlated. And the funny thing now is that if you analyze those models and you do, you look at the stationary state, yeah, the equilibrium state of those problems, they are in fact identical. Yeah. So if you go to long enough times and you take a slice here and you take a slice there, you would think, okay, they come from the same non-interacting problem. Yeah. And this is what makes the point. Yeah, dynamics is clearly more than statics. And although the stationary state of these systems is trivial, yeah, you find that, in fact, in this kinetically constrained system, you have a highly intricate dynamics with which the system approaches the stationary state. And those models are used, for instance, in the context of glass physics, yeah, because they are idealized representations of substances that undergo slow relaxation. All right, so now how does this link to Rydberg atoms? Yeah? So the question is now, look, I have represented, I have shown you an example of this kinetic constraint. This looks a bit artificial. Yeah? The question is now, can these kinetic constraints actually emerge rather naturally in one or another system? And of course, well, I wouldn't be standing here and talking about this if this wasn't the case, for instance, for these cold gases that are made up of Rydberg excited atoms. So, and what I will show you in this talk is, in fact, that these systems allow you to study features like slow and glassy relaxation, meaning, okay, emergence of new timescales, observation of transient phenomena and metastability, for instance, and will also allow the realization of systems with non-equilibrium stationary states. They allow you to study interesting things like collective dynamical features such as nucleation, aggregation, and growth. And an interesting aspect of this, I think, is that it allows the a controlled inclusion of quantum effects. Yeah? On top of this classical noise that gives rise to the spin flips, you can also include coherent fields that make the flips undergo a coherent evolution, for instance, between the up and the down state. Yeah? And this degree of quantumness is, in fact, controllable. Yeah? And also, what you can do is you can use those Rydberg states to kind of engineer exotic interactions. Yeah? I don't really want to discuss about this. I'll give you a teaser at the very end of the talk. Let's see how far we get. All right, atoms and Rydberg states, this is the overview again. So you look at our periodic table, atoms we are going to talk about are located here in the first column of the periodic table. They all have a very simple level structure. Robert talked about this earlier, so you can understand the levels basically in the same within the same framework that you're also using to understand the spectrum of a hydrogen atom, basically the atoms are labeled by quantum number n, which is the principal quantum number. In the case of hydrogen, they form highly degenerate multiplets. This is not the case for these heavier atoms like rubidium or lithium or potassium, where you see that these famous Rydberg formula is actually modified due to, through the inclusion of a quantum defect, which kicks in for low angular momentum states. And this means in practice that states, like for instance an electronic S state, yeah, which zero orbital angular momentum, is split away from this highly degenerate manifold of states, which is good, yeah, because you now can spectroscopically actually address them, yeah, which would be a bit more difficult if they were hiding within this manifold and mixing, for instance, under the influence of fields with the rest of the states. So just to show you, okay, how a Rydberg atom looks like, well, this is the radial wave function for the rubidium 39S state, and you see there's a large concentration, yeah, of the electronic density far away from the origin where the nucleus sits. And therefore, you can think of those atoms as forming some kind of dipolar structure, yeah, with a positively charged core and a negatively charged valence electron, and the distance here can be on the order of 1 micrometer, as Robert also said. So, in a nutshell, hydrogen-like, simple level structure, long lifetime. This is important to do coherent physics. And there's a large displacement between the charges, which gives rise to strong interactions as we discussed today. And for the case of S states, it's just like for the polar molecules that I have been discussing yesterday. You end up, due to the fact that those states are really spherically symmetric, with the van der Waals interaction, yeah, typically, which scales as the sixth power of the interparticle distance. Yeah. Just this is exactly also the same for ground state atoms, as Robert emphasized today. But the interesting thing is that this interaction coefficient scales with the 11th power of the principal quantum number. Yeah. So on this, therefore, it becomes extremely large as compared to ground state atoms. So typical interaction strengths are 10 orders of magnitude larger than what you would expect typically for atoms in the electronic ground state. All right. So Now what we want to do in order to do some theoretical many-body physics, we want to simplify the description of the system. Clearly, you don't want to carry with you all this complication of this level structure, yeah, because still, though it's simple, there are too many levels, yeah, to do many-body physics in a useful fashion. So what we do is we just focus on the essentials. Okay, we know that we typically find the atoms in the ground state. This is, of course, also not a single state, but let's, for the sake of simplicity, assume that, and we couple this state with an excitation laser via intermediate states to this NS state. Yeah, and in practice, you ignore also things like the fact that you need two lasers for that. You just say, okay, this becomes a single laser. We isolate those two near resonant levels and end up with our fictitious spin 1/2 particle just along the lines as I was showing you yesterday. So now the excitation laser is typically parametrized by a Rabi frequency, which corresponds to the electric field strength of the laser, and a detuning, yeah, which is basically the difference between the laser frequency and the frequency corresponding to the atomic transition. Yeah? And now if you wanted to write down a Hamiltonian for the single atom excitation, you would end up with this expression. And okay, this is also what I showed you yesterday. You have the sigma x and this n, yeah, which is the projector on the excited state. So this is the single body physics. Yeah? And now we want to do many body. So what do we do? So the convenient way of formulating the many-body dynamics here is in the framework of a quantum master equation. I also showed you examples of that yesterday in the context of photon-mediated dipole-dipole interaction. So the master equation looks like this. So we have here a coherent part, yeah, that describes the evolution of the density matrix of the atomic ensemble. And you see, this is governed by the Hamiltonian, by the quantum Hamiltonian. Here you recognize the bits that I just showed you before. So this is the Rabi frequency of the laser. This is the detuning, the frequency mismatch. And you just promote this to the many-body level by summing over k, yeah, where k is the atomic label. And then, of course, here you have the interaction potential, which is a density-density interaction. Yeah, I showed you also examples of that yesterday, which is parametrized through these coefficients here, which obey this van der Waals 1 over r to the 6 power law. Yeah? So this is the coherent part. So now the dissipative part is described by this structure. It has this Lindblad form, and it's actually diagonal. So, I mean, there are no collective effects, yeah? For reasons one can motivate and explain. So actually, this is really well tested. Yeah? So there's a very good agreement between the theoretical description given by this equation and actual experiments. So, and the two processes that we want to consider here, the ones that are dominant, I would say, in the context of these Rydberg gases, are given by either dephasing, yeah, I focus on this big time in the next few slides, so I don't want to discuss this now, and decay, yeah, which for simplicity we say is happening from the Rydberg state directly to the electronic ground state. This is, of course, an approximation. In practice, I mean, there are many states in between, but for the sake of extracting simple physics, this is actually a fairly good description. Yeah? All right, so those are the two processes that we, for instance, are able to capture within this formalism. And what I want to do is I want to focus on this dephasing and the following, yeah? Which quickly removes any sort of quantum coherence. Yeah? In a second, I show to you in more detail what I mean between the two states of this atom we are considering. Yes, exactly. Yeah, or for instance, a laser that has phase noise. Yeah. So, as I showed you, we can describe the evolution of our many-body system in terms of a quantum master equation, which is notoriously difficult to solve. You can nicely formulate it, and it's a very, very transparent representation of the physics there, but in the end, you have to solve it, which is almost always difficult if you want to do this for many bodies. And what you want to do is you want to assume and exploit in the following a separation of timescales, where we just decompose the evolution of our master equation into a fast part and into a slow part. Yeah. So the fast part, we say, is just given by this diagonal bits of the interaction energy. So it's the detuning and the interaction energy, which is a density-density interaction. It's so to say a classical interaction energy together with the dephasing noise. Yeah? And dephasing noise, what does it do? I said before, if, let's say, you have a quantum superposition of the down state and the up state, it will very quickly destroy this quantum superposition and convert it into a mixture of atoms pointing up plus atoms pointing down. A classical mixture, and the typical time at which this is taking place is 1 over gamma, 1 over this dephasing rate. Yeah? And in the end, once this dephasing noise has acted, only classical configurations remain. So now this is the fast dynamics, and clearly, okay, this is all diagonal, so something needs to happen on top of this, and you might have guessed it already. So we take the laser, yeah, because the laser is now driving dynamics here. Yeah? The laser wants to flip atoms, yeah, from up to down and from down to up, and we assume that this is the smallest scale in the problem for the moment. So and now what we can do is we can adiabatically eliminate, yeah, the fast dynamics from the problem. So what does it mean? So we now look in Liouville space, yeah, in which this state vector lives, yeah, of our system. So we focus here on this corner where we are only having classical configurations, because those are the configurations that will very quickly emerge due to this classical, due to this dephasing, which converts all quantum superposition to classical space states. So then we have some states with large rates, yeah, that decay quickly and that rotate quickly because they are strongly interacting and they have a large detuning. And then those classical configurations are connected to those states via the laser. Yeah. So on this we consider weak, and you see already the generic structure that pops up when you try to do some kind of second order perturbation theory. And this is what you do now. And once you do this second order perturbation theory, which is not difficult, you end up with an effective equation of motion that looks like this. Okay, so let's analyze this. Yeah. So if we now look at this part here, yeah, you find it just describes an ensemble of spins, yeah, that flip up and down with the same rate. Yeah, you see this immediately here. So if rho is, for instance, is down, yeah, then the sigma x promotes the component of the density matrix to up, yeah, and vice versa. Yeah. So this is this bit effectuates just spin flips, where the up rate is the same as the down rate. And the interesting thing is also, yeah, that this bit, which determines the dynamics of the system, yeah, also tells you what the stationary state of the system will be within the approximations we have been employing. Yeah. And you find that the stationary state is in fact trivial, yeah, because by trivial I mean that it's proportional to the identity. Yeah. All configurations appear with the same rate. You see, if you replace rho by 1, then you can see that sigma x times sigma x is 1 because it's a Pauli matrix. Minus 1 is 0. So the stationary state of this dynamics is completely trivial. But of course, I wouldn't tell you this if there wasn't a caveat here. And of course, this kicks in because of this gamma of k, which is now not a constant, but instead an operator. Yeah? And I will show you in detail in a second what shape this assumes. But this operator is exactly this kind of kinetic constraint that I was advertising before, yeah, because it somehow relates to the configuration of the surroundings of a given spin, and depending on the state of the configuration, it will either favor or disfavor, yeah, its state change of the spin we are considering. All right? Okay, so now let's analyze so the specific structure of these gammas, yeah, so of these kinetic constraints that we can actually expect. So, and we now distinguish between two cases. One case is resonant excitation, and one case is off-resonant excitation. When I say resonant excitation, then I mean that this delta, this detuning, is actually put to zero. Yeah? And if we put this delta to zero, and we just consider a very simple situation where we have only one excited atom at the origin, which we assume to be fixed, then we can now ask, okay, it's just coming out of the second order perturbation calculation, what is actually the rate for another spin here in its vicinity to flip? Yeah, and you see, this is the rate, yeah, and as a parameter enters this kind of capital R, which is, so to say, the blockade length or blockade radius, yeah, also very much related to what Robert said, but now in an incoherent setting. So this sets a length scale, which is determined by the interaction strength, and you see now all spins for which small r, so for which the displacement of the excited atom is larger than this big R, they will flip fast because the rate is 1. And all states, all spins that are close to this excited atom, they will undergo a very slow evolution. So they are more or less stuck or blockaded. So this is how this constraint works. So it makes dynamics far away from an excited atom fast and close to it slow. So then we can have a different situation where we start with an off-resonant excitation with a detuning. This should be delta. And so this small delta here. And we see, actually, there's only one slight modification. So in this bracket, there's now this small laser detuning coming in. And you see now what can happen is if this detuning is negative, yeah, there's a certain distance at which this bracket becomes zero and the rate becomes one, so it becomes large. So that means there is some kind of specific radius, so-called facilitation radius, which is given by the detuning in the properly scaled unit. So that's why it's the lowercase delta and not the capital delta, at which you favor frequent spin flips of an atom, whereas everywhere else the dynamics is slow. So, I mean, we have studied this theoretically together with Robert, but please forgive me. The PISA group is having the nicer data, I think. So that's why I'm showing the data from the PISA group in the next slide. So just to say, for comparison with the predictions that are coming out of this many-body dynamics. Okay, so let's look at this curve. In fact, three curves. Let's see what's plotted. Yeah. So here is time. So and here is the mean number of excitations. So we start in a state where all atoms are down, so there are no excitations. So, and now let's look at the case where we have the first situation, this one here, where we are resonant, with the laser with regards to the atomic transition. There you see very quickly a rise of the excitation number and it levels off at some point. Yeah, so this is the resonant case. Well, and in contrast to that, you can now look at the facilitated case. Yeah, you see it picks up much more slowly because at the beginning, there's no excitation happening. There's no excitation present in the system. So it means it takes a long while because the rate is slow. There's no facilitation possible since there's no excitation. So the first excitation requires some time to be created. But once this is created, so this picks up very quickly and further excitations are created. Yeah? No, but you can estimate. You can more or less calculate it. I show you a theory curve which in a second. So I will comment on that in a second. So and then alternatively, what you can do is you can now actually change the value of your detuning. So you can, instead of exciting the atoms with a negative detuning, which means it's the laser's off-resonant towards the blue, you can also go off-resonantly towards the red, which for short times shouldn't make a difference because there's anyway no facilitation at the very beginning because you need one excitation to set off this avalanche. So at very small times, the two situations should coincide, which indeed they do. Yeah, but you see in the green thing, unlike in the blue curve, so this off-resonant case doesn't show this kind of avalanche effect in the end, so it just levels off at very low excitation numbers. So and now you can do the theory, and on purpose, I don't show any explicit numbers here, so there has to be some rescaling done here. Robert is smiling at me already, because there are some intrinsic uncertainties in the experiment, like, okay, what's the actual atom number? So what's the actual Rabi frequency? There are also inhomogeneities, But what I want to stress is that, okay, the ballpark figures are okay, but what I want to stress is I now take a numerical run, for fixed parameters, and now do these three, calculate those three curves with exactly the same parameters. So relative to each other, they are fixed. Yeah, so there's no tweaking of these curves relative to each other. And now I can superimpose this, and you see it more or less works. At least, okay, we understand to a relatively good degree what is happening in the experiment. Yeah. Okay. So let's now move a bit beyond the experiment. Yeah, and let's have a closer look at the resonant dynamics. Yeah, because in the experiment so far, we have only measured the density, and I want to motivate that it's maybe a bit more interesting to look actually at the system in a somewhat higher resolution where we really see the configurations evolving, and we can also look at correlations. So, and in fact, in theory, you can also tune now at will, so to say, the parameters of the system, for instance, this blockade length, that I discussed before. So, and what I'm showing now in this plot here on a log-log scale is the evolution of the density of excited atoms, starting again from a state where there is no excitation, yeah, for different values of the interaction. Yeah. So the black curve here, so this is the black curve, is more or less the non-interacting case. Yeah. So nothing much is happening, blockade parameter is one. Whereas now if you, the other curves show an increasing, the situation for an increasing interaction strength up to R equals 8. And what you see now is that when one atom is actually blocking, yeah, 8 atoms, you see a very striking power law dependence here, yeah, in the growth of the density, which is actually interesting, I find. So initially we are uncorrelated, but at some point you have a correlated dynamics which gives rise to this power law behavior, and the power you can also estimate in 1D, it's 1/13. And okay, this is increasing interaction strength. You see it becomes more and more pronounced the larger the interaction becomes. Okay, so now let's look at the system. Let's look at the microscopic configurations of the system. And now, okay, what you would expect now is what you also see. Yeah, you see, expect that the density of the excitation increases as time passes. So low density, intermediate density, higher density. But now what you can do is you can actually rescale the magnification factor, so the zoom in factor that you use to observe these patches. And if you do it right, yeah, so then you can scale, yeah, your magnification factor as a function of time such that the system actually is not evolving, yeah, that it is getting stuck in this kind of configuration. Yeah. And this hints towards a self-similar evolution of the problem, so where time and space, so to say, don't evolve independently, but you have one variable combined of the two that is actually describing the evolution of the system. And we can now look at this in a bit more detail because one can actually extract this more or less analytically. So why do we observe the scale invariant relaxation? So first approximation or first consideration that leads to an approximation eventually is that the rate function, yeah, that I show here again, is actually highly peaked. So what does it mean? So if I now have an excitation here and I have an excitation here, so the next excitation is most likely to happen in the middle of two already excited atoms, yeah, just because there the interaction strength is weakest. So, and then what I also said before is that you have an excitation and a de-excitation at the same rate. So, but now we start actually from a situation where all atoms are down. So at the beginning, the excitation, yeah, the creation of Rydberg atoms will be far more important than the de-excitation of already existing Rydberg atoms because there are far less Rydberg atoms than actually atoms in the ground state. So you can actually remove this kind of de-excitation and everything becomes sort of deposition dynamics, yeah, where you just deposit excitations within your system and never remove any. So, and you just ask, okay, is this approximation a good one? Well, this is no rigorous answer, but you can just run the simulation with and without this de-excitation process, and you see then for this regime where you observe the power law behavior, both dynamics coincide, so that makes you confident that you can actually neglect this removal process. So, and then with these considerations, you find that the dynamics, yeah, of the system more or less proceeds like this. Yeah? So you have a certain density of excitations. So by the nature of these rate functions, they are more or less evenly spaced. Yeah? You are most likely to create the next excitations right in between already existing ones and the next ones as well right in between the already existing ones. So like this, the system you see already, yeah, a glimpse of it. Yeah, the system looks more or less the same at all times if you were just to zoom in further and further to compensate for this increase of density. All right, so let's formalize this a bit more. So this will bring us to an analytical solution of this problem. So what we do is we take this rate function and we assume already that there are a number of atoms inside the system so that there's interaction. Yeah. So because if you look at the two dilute situation where there are only few excitations, there's anyway no interaction. So in order for this correlated dynamics to kick in, there need to be interactions. Yeah. And if this is the case, you can actually neglect this one here in the denominator of this function, and you can approximate the rate function like this. And what you also assume now is that the distances are quantized, yeah, so that always powers of one, that they are always given by powers of one half, because the motivation is that excitations appear predominantly in the middle of already excited atoms. So, and now think in terms of particle distance. So we start with distance one. So then you place one excitation in the middle. So this is now two distances of one half. Place another particle. This is two distances of one quarter and one distance of one half. And now what you can do is you can write down a rate equation for the distribution of these interparticle distances. Yeah, it's just simple observing what this dynamics is and then reformulating it in this manner. And then you can go to a continuum limit, yeah, but by just expressing this in terms of derivatives here, doing some Taylor expansion, and you get a function like this. It's not really important what it looks like, but this is an equation of motion for this distribution function of interparticle distances. Yeah, we now went from a discrete variable n to a continuous variable x. And this we can actually, this is what I wanted to say. You find this funny power here, 13. So this is, of course, related to the power of the interaction. So whatever power alpha of the interaction appears in our system here, it's 6, yeah, will manifest itself in this exponent. So now you can analyze this equation, and you can find that actually it is solved by a function like this. So you see x and t, space and time, don't go independently, but they enter as this kind of product. Yeah? And this is exactly, so to say, this scale invariance that we have been observing in the numerics. So now if you take your numerics, yeah, and you plot the distribution function as a function of time, then you find for short times it's, of course, peaked at large interparticle distances. And as time evolves, it goes to smaller interparticle distances. But now if you apply this rescaling, you find that all these curves here fall nicely on top of one another. Yeah? So this is the numerical data with the scaling, and this confirms nicely that we indeed have the cell-similar evolution. So, and the conclusion from this is that even in this very simple setting, I guess, I don't know, Robert, you can object, yeah, but this is probably the most simple thing you can do in an experiment, turn on the laser, a bad laser on resonance, and see what happens. Yeah, even in this surprisingly basic setup, you find this highly correlated dynamics. Okay, at short times, of course, excitations are created at random. But then for longer times, when the interparticle distances becomes comparable to this blockade radius, you enter a regime in which you proceed with this kind of self-similar evolution towards stationarity. Yeah. All right, so, and this also works in higher dimension. I just want to show you this plot. I mean, you have to. And you see also in what sense this works. It's only approximately true. Yeah. So this is a real simulation. But you see this kind of, I'll leave it run for a moment. So we seed the system with this kind of checkerboard pattern. And you see it's not proceeding in a way that this checkerboard was preserved for all times. Yeah, but you see here these regions like here or here, yeah, where you see, okay, this is more or less looking like the situation we started from. Yeah, you again have this checkerboard pattern. It's a bit distorted. But you see then, this is serving for the initial as initial condition for the next time period. So you just zoom in and the system looks the same again. And you wait again for a moment, zoom in and the system will look the same again. So in 2D this works quite nicely. But it's not to be understood in an exact sense. It's more like, you see, it becomes, you see also this square structures. Okay, it becomes increasingly difficult to observe, but okay. If you do the analysis of the correlation functions, you see really this self-similarity persisting. All right. Are there experimental signatures? I mean, this is a bit challenging, and I just go back to this PISA experiment. And theoretically, this curve should correspond to the situation I was just considering. And then you can now superimpose this with the numerics, and you see, okay, this black is curved, the dashed curve is the t to the 1/5 power. It looks more or less okay, but this is also a Lin scale. So, I mean, it's not really convincing. Yeah? So one would have to do a very carefully designed experiment, I think, in order to observe this algebraic growth of the power. So 1/5 is what one would expect in three dimensions. Okay, so I still have time. No? Okay, so this was everything I had to say for the moment concerning this resonant excitation. But now let's look at the case in which we excite atoms off resonantly. Yeah, and before I come back to the Rydberg atoms, I just want to have a small detour, and I want to introduce you to the contact process, which is somewhat going under different names. It's game of life, like it's in essence, it's a cellular automaton, yeah, which obeys a number of rules. Yeah, and I come to the rules in a second. The important thing is that you have an order parameter that you think describes the physics of the system, which is just given by the density of active sites. So each site can be either alive or dead, or up or down, or Rydberg or ground state. Yeah, I mean, use the notion that you like best. And now let's consider the rules, yeah, with which this process is taking place. So one rule is just death or decay. Yeah, so you can remove an excitation from a site and then it's gone. And another rule is branching. Yeah, so one excitation can spawn another excitation on an adjacent lattice site. Yeah. And what you find is, when you look at this dynamics, is that there's actually a unique absorbing state. Yeah, that means the state in which everything is dead will never come back to the living, right? So because there, you need this facilitation, yeah, in, or this branching in order to create density. So once everything is decayed, you will get stuck in this absorbing state. So, but now what you can do is you can, of course, let the decay fight against the branching, and this is what's plotted here. So branching, the relative strength of the branching is increased into this direction, and then you find if you exceed a critical value, then you go from this inactive phase, which is formed by this absorbing state, which is non-fluctuating, to an active phase. Yeah, and what delimits those two phases is a second order phase transition, which belongs to the directed percolation universality class. So why is this interesting? Well, it's allegedly the simplest non-equilibrium universality class. And although it's so simple, we have hardly any experimental realization of this. Yeah? So there's one experiment in 2D conducted in a system that encompasses liquid crystals. Don't ask me exactly about the details. And then there's another nice work that appeared this year, actually, where I think the authors looked at the evolution of a fluid, yeah, through some porous medium. So both of these systems realize in one way or another an instance of this directed percolation universality class. Yeah, so far in 3D, there doesn't seem to be an implementation, actually. All right, so now you can ask naturally, okay, how do we do with the Rydberg atoms? Is this feasible with these Rydberg atoms? Because clearly we have the branching, so I advertised before this facilitated excitation. Yes, this we have. Decay we have as well, no problem. And the only problem here is that a unique absorbing state does not exist, yeah, because I showed you already in these experimental curves before that even if you start in a situation where all atoms are de-excited, at some point you will excite one due to off-resonant excitation processes. It's unlikely, but you'll do it eventually, yeah, and you cannot really inhibit this for real. So this unique absorbing state does not exist. Fair enough. And interactions also, of course, extend beyond nearest neighbor, yeah, which is also an issue. And still, you can see, okay, what can we do? And on top of this, if in any real experiment, you're, of course, not in the thermodynamic limit, but you have finite sizes. You have tens of perhaps hundreds of atoms if you were thinking of lattice experiments. All right, so let's now look at a small system which implements a clean version of this contact process. Yeah? So that means, okay, we now look at the density, yeah, and see how it evolves as a function of time for different values of this lambda, of this branching ratio. You see, when the branching ratio is below the critical branching ratio, then these curves pretty much approach the absorbing state, so density decays to zero. And if you are above this critical lambda, above the second order transition, you find, okay, those states, those initial conditions bring you to a state with finite density. And in between, there's a critical curve which exhibits, at least over some parameter regime, over some time domain, an algebraic scaling. So this is the critical curve. And okay, you can also collapse the data if you rescale these curves accordingly and they collapse on two master curves. So this is the dynamics. So this is the evolution of the density in time. And what you can also do is you can look at the statics. Yeah? And of course, now that you are having a finite size system, 50 sites, you expect, of course, no sharp transition, but a smoothed out transition. Yeah? But then if you pinpoint this transition point, yeah, more or less precisely, you are also able to at least superimpose this expected power law curve, and you see it's not too far off. I just want to emphasize this is no fitted data. Yeah? So it's just taking the known value from the literature and superimposing it here on the numerics. Yeah? All right, so now you can ask what would happen if you were to use Rydberg atoms, yeah, for this. Yeah? And you see now the behavior is pretty much similar, but you see this bending here. Yeah? So you see the bending here. And where you had in the clean system this algebraic decay for a long time, so you see at some point this algebraic decay in the Rydberg system is leveling off. Yeah? And this is due to the fact that we have these off-resonant processes, yeah, which prevent this unique absorbing state from existing. And at the end of the day, they will change the physics if you look at the system only for long enough timescales. So looking at the Rydberg gas in the stationary state doesn't really make a lot of sense. And well, for several reasons, because at some point your experiment also stops working. So, but what you will see is that there's a manifestation of this closeness to the directed percolation transition here in this intermediate transient regime. And you see here over roughly an order of magnitude at least a scaling and a behavior that is reminiscent of an algebraic decay. So you could be hoping that at least in an experiment you would be able to see something like this. So, and this is of course conversely the curves here, so it doesn't look better than in the ideal situation. Still it's smoothed out and it's difficult to fit the data. So now what you can do is you can do an experiment. I just want to emphasize, yeah, that this is extremely preliminary data from the PISA group. So what they do is they look at a quasi one-dimensional cloud. It's a similar experiment to the one I showed before. They excite atoms in here off-resonantly, and then they count in the end, okay, after applying an electric field pulse that converts the Rydberg atoms into ions, the ions that are being created. So and those are proportional to the number of Rydberg atoms that you had before in the cloud. So now if you change the Rabi frequency here, so the strength of the laser driving, which is, so to say, proportional to the branching, yeah? So this think of this as the branching strength, and you see there is some kind of phase transition-like, smoothed out phase transition-like behavior. And in the fluctuations, you also see there's some kind of peak structure. And if you wanted to, and okay, this is really preliminary, you could also recognize some scaling with an exponent that is not too far off the one you would expect for one-dimensional directed percolation. But okay, this is could well be a coincidence. Yeah. So, but okay, it's at least an interesting direction to pursue. And okay, we will definitely hopefully firm this up and then come back to you with a stronger conclusion. All right, so now you can ask, okay, what's the point? So why would I, yes? You would need to increase the detuning. It's a bit of a technical bit. Yeah, but also not excessively long. I mean, in the end, look, I mean, those were orders of magnitude on the time axis. At the end, your experiment, I mean, you know better than me, but you are nodding. Your experiment does something. I mean, it doesn't run forever. Yeah, not over 6-7 orders of magnitude. What gamma t? I'm certainly not able to comment on this. Yeah. We have in the PISA experiments, The absolute time scale is on the order of a millisecond. Yeah. All right. So far, we had this effective classical model, so where we had coherent excitation and interaction fighting with decay and dephasing, which eventually turned everything into some effectively classical model, although, of course, the physics, the underlying physics is quantum. But now the question we can ask is, okay, what happens actually if we get rid of this dephasing, yeah? If we really have quantum coherent excitation fighting against decay. And this is the strength of this Rydberg system, yeah? It's not, so to say, so much that you can reproduce another instance of directed percolation. It's really a platform which allows you to, he agrees with me, which allows you to study the influence of quantum effects in such systems and make them, let them compete also with classical rates. Okay, let's remove this dephasing and let's go to a quantum description. And the simplest version that you can write down, and you can approximately realize this up to some corrections with Rydberg atoms, is this kind of quantum kinetic constraint. You see, this is just a coherent evolution. Yeah? So this is a spin flip from up to down coherently, which only takes place if either the left neighbor or the right neighbor of your kth atom is excited. So this is kind of a quantum branching, and this is now going in both ways. Yeah? All right. So I don't want to talk too much about it, just motivate, I mean, what you might be able to find. You can do some mean field treatment of the system. This is the first thing you can do. And then you find that instead of a second order transition that you encountered in this classical problem, where you had classical branching instead of this quantum branching, you find a first order transition. Yeah? You still have an absorbing state, but you see if you start now, if you increase your branching, your system, your density jumps up, yeah, to this state. So it's a first order transition. You can also do some numerics, and you see indeed bimodal distribution, which is a hallmark of a first order transition. There's a much more thorough analysis, yeah, of this, yeah, given in the poster by Matteo Marcuzzi that's hanging over there. I invite you to talk to him about this, and I just show you this kind of phase diagram that you can now plot when you let this quantum branching fight against the classical branching, and you find new structures. You find, okay, this second order transition line. So here's the classical DP. So this is a second order directed percolation transition. So this extends into the quantum regime, and then at some point it becomes a first order transition, and there's some other critical point in between. Matteo is the expert on that. He will guide you through this. If you like, what I want you to know about is actually this, yeah, in the last 5-6 minutes. It's relating to actual efforts that might be relevant ultimately maybe in the domain of magnetic resonance imaging, and they relate to so-called hyperpolarization methods, yeah, with which you can polarize ensembles of nuclear spins. So this is important in the context of magnetic resonance imaging, because the sensitivity of your signal, yeah, that you extract is actually dependent on how well you can polarize your nuclei, yeah, of the tissue or the material that you want to scan. Yeah? And for this, it's important to have an imbalance, yeah, in the probability of those nuclei pointing up versus pointing down. Yeah? And you now find that in order to create an imbalance, yeah, of course, in thermodynamic equilibrium, you have to lift the degeneracy of those two spin states. Yeah? And for this, you apply a magnetic field on the order of maybe 10 Tesla or so. Yeah, and then if you look at this at room temperature, yeah, you find that this imbalance is 1 part per million. Yeah, so it's not impressive. So you can go better than this. Yeah, you go to 0.01 Kelvin and a magnetic field that is twice as strong, and then you get a tenth. Yeah, so but clearly this is brute force. Yeah, so you really have to invest a lot. But this is for thermal equilibrium. Now, what you might be thinking of, okay, why bother with thermal equilibrium? Let's go out of equilibrium. Yeah? And this is actually being used, yes, or known already, I think, for tens of years, 50 years or so, yeah, that once you drive a system of these nuclei out of equilibrium, I'll tell you in a second how this works, you can actually achieve polarizations, okay, still at relatively low temperature of a Kelvin, of 0.6, 0.8 at moderate magnetic fields. So, and how does this work? Yeah. So, you have your ensemble of nuclear spins. So, this is the simplest manifestation of what one can do. So, so we have an ensemble of nuclear spins, and now, in this ensemble, within this ensemble, there's immersed a single electron. Yeah. And what you can do is now you can drive this electron with a microwave field and saturate this transition, and you can transfer the polarization of from the electron to the nuclear spin. So at first, this transfer of polarization, yeah, is taking place via spin-spin interactions, yeah, exchange interactions, so from the electron to the nuclei, and then later within the bulk of the nuclei through spin-spin interaction between the nuclei. So this takes a while, yeah? So I mean, this is a simulation, and okay, you see this is on the order of minutes, and it can be even hours, yeah? So you see the electron is very quickly polarized with this method, but then those spins take a while, yeah, before they pick up the polarization and actually, yeah, assume relatively high polarization values. Okay, so now, what are the challenges here from theory? I mean, there's lots of theory on this, yeah? So, but it's mostly, I would say, okay, I don't want to shout too loudly because, okay, I'm by no means an expert on this, but it's kind of phenomenological, and it's only looking at very small systems for which you can then come up with exact solutions, like 10 spins, for instance. But it doesn't really allow you, yeah, to study systematically, for instance, this diffusion of polarization from the electrons through the nuclear bulk, yeah? Because for this you need large ensembles of thousands of spins to really confidently be able to establish this. So understanding is the role of diffusion is one challenge for theory. Then, of course, the simulation of large-scale systems. And in the end, once you have achieved this, you also want to optimize your systems. And for instance, you want to find strategies for achieving even higher polarizations, ultimately, in the stationary state. So, and well, at least our contribution to the solution is to adapt this methodology that we have been developing in this context of the Rydberg gas. So you can then, by the same strategy with which I derived these classical equations, you can also understand the dynamics of this coupled electron spin, nuclear spin system within a framework of rate equations that you can derive, and you can, in the end, you get diffusion, which features kinetic constraint and not just spin flips, single spin flips that are governed by a kinetic constraint. You really get two particle processes which are effectuated by this constraint. And then you find that it actually describes the physics of the system fairly well, at least in regimes where you can establish this connection, namely regimes of small sizes where you can really compare the exact calculation to the effective calculation. And you see all these colorful curves are superimposed by black curves. One is showing the effective theory, this classical theory, which allows you to simulate large spin systems compared to the exact theory. So, and also what I want to emphasize is that this is actually, I would say it's really surprising that it works so well, yeah, because you have a huge separation of timescales here. Yeah. We look here at 10 to the 3 seconds, yeah, and the microscopic dynamics is on the order of gigahertz, yeah, so it's 10 to the minus 9 seconds, yeah, so there's a huge mismatch of energy scales, and yet you are able to describe, yeah, by modeling this microscopic dynamics, really the long time behavior of those systems. All right, this allows you to simulate large systems, for instance, for a single spin, you really see how this polarization develops. I mean, you can include effects like dipole-dipole patterns. You see it's not isotropic, the interaction between the electronic spin and the nuclear spin. This you can include. And now what you can also do is you can drive this a bit further, because this is the simplest manifestation of this physics, where you have just a single electron. You can also have two electrons, which then give rise to other processes, yeah, spin flips, where you have a collective flipping of the two electrons that take with them another nuclear spin. You see, okay, this flips from down, up, down, to up, down, up, and you see you have generated a polarized nucleus. You can understand this. You can optimize, so to say, the rate for those three-body processes. You see two electrons that depends on the distance. This is a measure of the distance between the electrons, and you see you find in certain regimes where these three-body processes are more important than the two-body processes, and we can really use this as a means to optimize the physics and the polarization buildup. Okay, so this brings me to the summary. I hope I could convince you that Rydberg atoms provide a rich playground to address problems that might be of relevance, for instance, in soft matter physics, or at least that resemble situations that you might encounter in soft matter physics. So the name of the game are kinetic constraints, which make the relaxation very intricate, but might still favor a trivial stationary state. I showed you an example of this. This is the self-similar relaxation of the Rydberg gas. I talked about this non-equilibrium phase transition in which you can now, in principle, also introduce quantum effects, and you can study what they do to the phase diagram. And then in the end, I showed you how this methodology can be applied to some real-world example for in the domain of nuclear magnetic resonance. And okay, you can also drive this further. You can go to lattices. You can go to multi-species systems. So there's lots of things that can be explored and that I can bug the experimentalists with. So I hope you enjoyed this, and thank you very much for your attention.